everyone. Welcome back to my channel, or welcome to my channel if you've never been here before. Hey! So in today's video, we will be covering the case of Danielle Robinson. So this case is nothing short of disturbing, and the police work in this case couldn't be any more subpar. So if you want to know more about Danielle Robinson and what exactly happened to him, then keep on watching. So Danielle Robinson is 24 years old. He was born on January 17th, 1997 in Columbia, North Carolina. So he was actually born without a right hand. I'm not sure the story behind that, but he was just born without a right hand. His mom actually tried to get him to wear a prosthetic, but he did not want to do that. He was like, this is how I was born. This is just me. I am fine just like this. So he attended AC Flora High School in Forest Acres, South Carolina. And in 2019, he actually graduated from the College of Charleston in Charleston, South Carolina, with a major in archaeology. So Daniel became interested in geology his first semester in college. Like, he took one class and he became hooked. Like, that was it for him. He did not want to do anything else but that. After graduation, he landed a career as a field hydrogeologist for a firm called Matrix New World in Phoenix, Arizona. His father said that he loved his new job. He was super excited to start. And I mean, he was living his dream. That's literally what he loved to do. That's what he went to college for. And he was very, very excited to start his new job. His coworker said that he was a very smiley, happy-go-lucky person who loved talking to everybody. His family said that he had a huge passion for music and was very adventurous and loves to travel. So on Wednesday, June 23rd, 2021, Daniel actually went to work like any other day. He arrived at work around 9 a.m. on Sun Valley Parkway and Cactus Road, where he met his co-worker, Kenneth. His jobs usually takes him out to remote locations, out into the desert, where he would work in extreme conditions. I mean, I can only imagine how hot it is, and travel long distances to work on projects. But that day, when Daniel arrived to work, his co-worker said that he was actually acting a little funny. He was saying things that didn't make sense, like, did Kenneth wanted to go home to Arizona to rest for 15 minutes? And Kenneth said that he had just like a very spaced out look in his face. Like, he just looked very spaced out, like he just had something else on his mind. And at one point, he thought that it could have possibly been that he was on something like drugs or something like that. But Kenneth said that his pupils weren't dilated, so he doubted that he was on any type of drugs. So after about 15 minutes of working, Daniel went to his vehicle. So at first, Kenneth thought that he was just going to his vehicle to grab something and then, you know, get back to work. But then he actually got into his car, locked his door, put on the seatbelt, and then decided to wave goodbye to Kenneth and leave the location that they were working. And that was actually the last person who physically seen him. So Kenneth was immediately concerned. I mean, who wouldn't be? Because he didn't really tell him where he was going, or he didn't really say why he was leaving. Like, he just left. So he was extremely concerned. He then went ahead to go call their project manager, Steve, because he wanted to know, you know, maybe he went back to the plant, or, you know, just to see, or maybe he called Steve to say he wasn't feeling good or he was leaving work or something. So Steve actually said that he haven't heard from Danielle and no one from the company heard from him neither. So around 3 p.m., Kenneth was made aware, I'm guessing by Steve, that no one heard from him still. This is when he became concerned and started looking for him himself. So he tried to look around for him in the desert, but he actually did not found him. So around this same time, his family actually became extremely concerned because they haven't heard from him all day. And then they were trying to reach him. And usually he keeps in close contact with all of his family member or someone throughout the day. So they actually immediately became concerned. And for whatever reason, that very minute, they decided to call the police to report him as a missing person. So when the police arrived at the location, within minutes after they were called, they looked looked around, but apparently they did not find anything. They didn't see anything. They decided to contact Daniel's family to ask them to look at his social media to see if he posts anything, you know, that could probably indicate where he went or post anything to see where he's at. His dad went ahead and checked his Instagram. And then this is when his dad actually found out that all the pictures on his Instagram were deleted. And then he found out that his profile was deactivated as well. So after this situation, the family actually just had a hard time getting any information from the police. They said it was almost like pulling teeth. But his family actually said that he was acting a little weird days leading up to his disappearance. So his father actually said that he wasn't really acting weird. You know, he just felt like he was just having a bad day. It wasn't so weird. However, I'm guessing he went to a Waffle House. So the waitress at the Waffle House said that he was acting very off. His sister actually said that he was acting off as well. His sister actually lived in Arizona. So he actually texted his sister saying that he had an emergency, but then his sister tried to call him and he wouldn't answer the phone, which is just so weird because, you know, if you text someone saying that you have an emergency and they call you back, they would expect you to answer, but he didn't answer his phone at all. And the sister also said that about a few days before he disappeared, he actually showed up at her house and then he sat on the couch for about 30 minutes without saying a thing and then just decided to leave. So it's almost like he wanted to talk to her about something, but just decided not to, but just changed his mind and then decided to leave. His father actually told police that days leading up to his disappearance, he actually told him and other family members that there was a woman that he was apparently in love with. So his father thought it was very strange because he was like, well, you don't know very much about this woman, so how could you possibly be in love with her? And it was a woman who he recently met. His coworkers also said that he told them about the woman as well, but a lot of what he was saying to them about her didn't make sense. So it's almost like he was saying a lot without saying much. But he actually did tell them that he was in love with this woman that he cannot have. He didn't really say why he couldn't have her, but he just said that he couldn't have her. It could be that she was married, or maybe she was in a relationship, or maybe he just felt like, you know, she was possibly out of his league and he felt intimidated. Whatever reason it was, he did say that he was in love with the woman and he could not have her. So this woman, her name is Caitlin. So she actually made contact with him, I would say about a week or two before his disappearance. So apparently Daniel had like a side hustle. So he was also doing Instacart. So Caitlin was at home one Saturday night with her friends. They were hanging out, they were drinking, and then they decided to order more alcohol. So Daniel was the deliver person who decided to deliver the alcohol to Caitlin's house. So once Daniel arrived, this was the night of June 12th, Caitlin decided to invite Daniel into the home to hang out with her and her friends because she said that she was drunk and he looked like a really nice person. She said that he was kind of short and he didn't have a hand. So she kind of felt safe. Like she felt like he wouldn't necessarily be a danger to them. So this is why she decided to invite him in. So as the night proceeded, they then decided to exchange numbers and then he went home. Now, the only problem is he kept texting her after that. Like he sent her several text messages and then on several accounts, apparently he showed up to her house unannounced. She did ask him to stop texting her and he did stop texting her. So she thought that that was very weird of him. He also told her that he couldn't stop thinking about her, but the messages for the most part were merely one-sided. Like he was just texting her all these messages, pouring out his feelings to her, and she wasn't really responding to the message. So on July 17th, a rancher was in the area where Daniel was last seen. I'm not sure what exactly he was doing, whatever ranchers do, I'm not sure what they do, but he was in the area doing that stuff when he actually discovered Daniel's vehicle. So Daniel had a 2017 blue Jeep Renegade. So he discovered his vehicle literally 4 miles or 3 miles. Actually, I saw articles saying 4 miles, I saw 3 miles, and I saw 2 miles, but it doesn't even matter. It's still a very close proximity from where Daniel was last seen. When he saw the vehicle, he actually called police and the police came, and the vehicle was actually seems like it was in a very, very bad crash, and it rolled over several times and was just laying on the side. So I'm not sure if it was hit or if the damages came from the vehicle rolling over several times. So his cell phone, wallet, keys, and clothes were all found in the same area where his vehicle was found. The only problem is he was not there, so he was not in the vehicle. So immediately after this, the police decided to tell the family that there were no foul play involved. They didn't really do any investigation. They basically came to this conclusion because there weren't any blood in the car, which is just so crazy to me, because if a vehicle crashed and was in this condition and rolled over so many times, and I mean, not even 1 ounce of blood, how did that not raise suspicion? If anything, I would even be more suspicious that there wasn't any blood, as if this is totally normal to get in an accident and strip naked and walk out in public. Like, I just don't even understand. But anyways, his family was not buying it. So his dad decided to drive all the way from South Carolina to Arizona to basically take matters into his own hand, since authorities won't take this seriously. So his father hired a private investigator, Jeff McGrath, who was actually a retired police personnel, to help him with the case. So the investigator actually found that he was wearing a seatbelt at the time of the crash, or the seatbelt was locked at the time of the crash. So they also found that someone tried to turn on the ignition a total of 46 times. 46 times after the airbags were deployed. And they also found out that the vehicle was driven an additional 11 miles after the crash. They also found that the crash happened about 4 hours after he was last seen. So he left work around 9:15. So the crash happened around sometimes after 1 o'clock before 1:30. All of the information that they gathered, his father actually believed that the whole situation just looked staged. It didn't look like he really crashed. They just felt like it was staged and that he was not in the vehicle at the time of the crash.
I'm leaning more towards, I don't think Daniel was in that vehicle.
The private investigator working with the Robinson family suspects foul play is involved. He says there are too many unanswered questions raised by data recovered from the vehicle.
The vehicle had 11 additional miles on it from the time the airbags deployed. It had 46 additional ignition cycles on it after the airbags deployed.
Jeff McGrath also notes red paint transfer on the right side of the Jeep.
The vehicle was tipped over on the passenger side, so there's no red paint in this area. So how that got there, that's why I'm saying that vehicle did not crash here. That vehicle was, its last place of rest was here, but something was going on with that.
So the Buckeye Police Department actually said that leading up to the discovery of Daniel's vehicle, they did 4 ground searches and 2 aerial searches, which I don't understand how, because the vehicle was found only 4 miles away from where he was last seen. So how did you not find the vehicle? So it's either they didn't do those searches like they say they did, or as his father and the PI believe, the accident was actually staged and then the vehicle was placed there at a later time. And they also said that after his vehicle was found, they did another 3 searches and they just didn't find Daniel. The police actually told his father, I don't know if he was joking when he said this or if he was dead serious, but either way, like, the police literally told his father, maybe he decided to strip his clothes off, get naked, join a monastery, and decided to become a monk. Not once, but twice. Like, are you kidding me? Like, this man is literally trying to find his son and you're joking. Like, I don't know if this was a joke or if it's something that is possible, but either way, it's just ridiculous. So Daniel's family was the one who actually had to put pressure on the Buckeye Police Department for them to even bring a helicopter to the scene to be able to search to see if they can find him. So a human skull was actually found while they were searching for Daniel, but on July 31st, it was confirmed that it was not his. But here's the scary thing. So his dad actually has been organizing searches every single week since he went missing. Like, he would search by himself daily, but then every single Saturday, he would organize a search party and get volunteers from the public. And since they've been searching, they literally found the remains of at least 6 people who had went missing. One of the victims went missing as far as 2010, which is crazy. Like, this just really shows that the cops are really not searching for missing people like they say that they are.
All right, today is November 6th, Saturday morning. We came out here to the desert area where Daniel was last seen and where our searches have been continuing now for 14 weeks. My investigator partner and I had an idea to run down an area that had not been searched, and it was further south, a couple miles south of the entrance road off of Cactus. And you can see behind me, we did identify, they were human leg bones, human femurs. We found a couple femurs and we found hip bone. At this point, the medical examiners confirmed it, and we don't know whose it is, but that'll be in the days to come. But for now, we have see Buckeye Police has taped off the scene, and we'll wait for further information.
And mind you, this is the same police department who told Daniel's family that they searched the ground 6 times and searched via air 2 times. So how did you organize 8 different search parties but never found these remains? That's odd. So months went by and they had no information. They had no leads. Authorities basically gave up on the family. So his father actually created a Twitter and just started asking for help from the public. He literally started tagging celebrities, doing whatever he needs to do to get awareness, to bring awareness to his son's case, because the media weren't covering it. They also created a GoFundMe so they can collect donation to aid in these search parties, because these search parties are actually very, very expensive. So he was able to get help from the public. And I can't even imagine what it's like for you to actually have to go out there to search for your own family member. Like, I just can't even imagine the level of anxiety that brings. Like, his dad said that he literally does not even sleep at night. Like, he doesn't even sleep at night because he's just really on a mission to be able to find his son. So as of today, we're in November. So he went missing in June. It's literally almost 5 months since he's been missing. The family, they still have no clues to where he is. So they're literally still searching every single day. If he's out in the desert still, then it's very unlikely that he's alive, because I mean, it's been 5 months. The desert gets as hot as about 115 degrees. And I mean, he doesn't have water. He doesn't seem to have anything, not even his cell phone. So yeah, they're not sure, but they're still not giving up hope. They're still searching for him every single week. So what exactly happened to him? Here are some possible theories. So this girl that he was in love with, could it be that she was possibly married, or she was, you know, had a boyfriend, and maybe because he kept texting her obsessively, this was her word, she said that he was obsessed with her. Maybe she told her boyfriend or something, and he decided to take matters into his own hands. And the reason why this is possible is because the last time he actually texted her was about 18 hours before he disappeared. He sent her a text message, and that text message was actually a little weird as well. The text message said, "The world can be better, but I'll have to take all the time I can, or we can, or whatever to name it. I'll either see you again or I'll never see you again." I'm not sure what exactly that meant, but that's what it said. She didn't respond to him, but I mean, anything is possible, you know, anything is possible. Could it be that she told somebody, maybe a brother, maybe, I don't know, you know, maybe a family member, and they decided to take matters into their own hands. Also, could the coworker be involved? I mean, he was the last person that seen him alive. So who knows? And another possible theory is that he could have got into an accident and then hit his head and then lose his memory and kind of forget who he was and then wandered off into the desert. However, if that was the case, I'm sure he probably would have been injured from the act if he was actually in the car. I mean, the vehicle rolled over. You'll see a picture of what the car looks like. So if he was in that car, there's no way he wasn't hurt. It probably wouldn't have been badly hurt, but he definitely would have been hurt. So if he would have wandered off into the desert, he would have only been able to get that far. He didn't have a cell phone. He didn't have water with him. So he probably wouldn't have gotten that far. I don't believe that was the case. Or he probably went hitchhiking with somebody and they decided to take him. But no one knows what happened. To this day, he's still missing. His father is a trained soldier and he is definitely going to do whatever he can to find his son.
And I really believe I'm have my son back alive.
David Robinson is on the biggest mission of his life. After serving two tours in the deserts of Afghanistan, the Army vet has no plans to leave the deserts of Arizona until he finds his 24-year-old son, Daniel.
Treat it like a mission. I keep saying it, I'm a professional soldier. I do my job and find my son. He's my son, I'm his father, and it's my job.
He decided to relocate to Arizona and he said that he's literally not leaving until he find his son. So yeah, that is it for this video. I will link a petition down below for you to sign and also the GoFundMe. And if anything else comes out about this case, then I'll also put it down in the comment section. So yeah, that is it for this video. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel, and I'll see you in my next one. Bye-bye.